The French are many things: suave, sophisticated, cultured, and apparently delicious if you season them properly. Welcome to Sick Flicks, where I take a deep dive into the cinematic sewer to help you embrace your inner gore geek. Join me today as we break down Xavier Gens' French horror film, Frontiers. Released in 2007, Frontiers is part of the short-lived New French Extremity movement, a wave of graphic, gory, and socially aware French genre films that were popular in the early part of the 21st century. Frontiers is a middle-of-the-road entry in the movement, a film filled with ideas that never get fully explored, and a premise that should be intimately familiar to anyone who's seen Tobe Hooper's Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Jen's film flirts with the idea of providing social commentary on contemporary politics, but then quickly dumps the lofty ambitions for a more traditional Nazi cannibals turn their unwitting guests into human barbecue narrative as the film progresses. Despite the missed opportunity to say something deeper about the state of the world, and the film's lengthy running time and derivative narrative stylings, Frontiers is still fairly entertaining. But is it a sick flick? Let's get to the gore and find out. The film opens with some ultrasound footage and a political quote, which is maybe the most subtle this film will ever get. From there, we jump to this montage of footage that looks like it could have been filmed last week in America. I'll say this about Frontiers, it was a bit ahead of the curve in predicting the current political climate in both Europe and the USA. Don't let all this subtext put you off, though. We'll be getting to the Nazi cannibals soon enough. After all that stock footage ends, we find ourselves right in the middle of a real riot. These dudes are fleeing the cops like they just stole a box of donuts. Give us the bear claw and no one gets hurt. You'll pry this bear claw from my cold dead hands, pig. This seems like a good time to note that Xavier Gens clearly graduated from the Michael Bay School of Action Choreography. Yeah, just cut a lot, and bounce the camera around. They'll think something exciting is happening. While the shootout at the OK Corral is raging outside, these two head indoors and take cover. Back outside, Alex and his droogs are cornered by the Popo. 5-0 makes a rookie cop mistake and gets to eat a little gun sandwich as penance. No, don't break my dental implants. I only had 45 more payments. With the cop incapacitated, they've got time to take a phone call. From the girl in the building.
Sammy s'est fait tirer dessus, il pisse le sang. Je fais quoi, moi?
After some more exposition, where we learn that Captain Pistol Whip is sleeping with the girl inside, more cops show up. The gang then regroups to weigh their options. Yaz wants to take her brother to the hospital, even if that means they get arrested. But her friends here aren't quite so willing to risk a trip to the Bastille. Cooler heads eventually prevail, and they come up with this plan.
Bon, j'ai une solution. Tom, tu pars avec Farid. Vous trouvez une piole pas loin de la frontière en nous attendant. Moi, je m'occupe d'accompagner Madame et son tampon aux urgences, et on vous rejoint dès qu'on sera sorti de ce merdier.
With the plan made, it's time for some more exposition. That baby at the beginning? She's not planning on keeping it. Hey, does this jacket make me look fat? No, your head makes you look fat.
T'en es à combien?
Je suis à 125,000.
So, wait, these guys weren't just some protesters out for a little looting. It looks like they used the riots to pull off a heist. Hans Gruber totally approves. Yaz and Sammy make it to the hospital. And I'm not a doctor, but Sammy's not looking too hot. But he's not so far gone that he can't offer up some advice.
Yaz, garde-le. Le bébé, garde-le.
With the cops coming, he sends her on her way. And that seems pretty altruistic, except given what's gonna happen in the rest of this movie, she might have just preferred to stay behind and get arrested. And then he croaks. Well, thanks, Sammy. We could have just skipped this whole side trip, man. Way to be selfish. With the cop closing in, they take off into the night. Damn it, almost had them. I really gotta lay off the French pastries. Back in the car, Alex is worried Sammy's gonna rat them out.
Ton connard de frère va nous balancer, on est bien dans la merde maintenant.
Il va rien balancer du tout.
Yeah, man, dead men tell no tales and all that. Also, your grief counseling skills could use some work. So, does this mean I get Sammy's cut of the money? I mean, I'm just asking. Meanwhile, over in our other movie, Tom and Fareed have made it out of the city. And Tom's sending Fareed packing because he wants all that sweet loot for himself.
Je suis désolé, mec, je garde la thune des sangs.
Quoi?
Psych, it was just a joke. That Tom, what a kidder. After a chat with Alex, Tom and Fareed find themselves in a Robert Frost poem. I'm guessing they're gonna regret the road not taken before this is over. Or not, this Airbnb looks pretty sweet. They head inside and meet these two charmers.
Mais en tout cas, mesdames, franchement, je pensais pas qu'en venant dans un coin paumé comme ici, on tomberait sur des beautés comme vous. Vous êtes vraiment superbe.
Hold up, I thought the French were supposed to be masters at romance and flirting. Step your game up, Tom. Gilberta calls for Getz, who's all like, hey, I'm trying to do taxidermy in here. Have I got to do everything around this dump? They settle in for some drinks, and Tom's still trying his pickup lines. And apparently they work, because next thing you know, he's getting some action. Meanwhile, I'd like to take this time to point out that Farid is a terrible wingman.
T'as l'air gêné? T'es timide?
Ah non non, j'ai une copine moi.
Tom takes off with the ladies, leaving Farid downstairs with Getz, who kinda looks like WWE superstar Triple H when he's off the trend in human growth hormone. Also, Farid should probably book an appointment with Dr. Pimple Popper. He's got a cyst or lipoma on his head. Yeah, this isn't creepy at all. Upstairs, Tom and Farid are making some movies for their new Pornhub channel. Tom's like, I'm gonna direct and star in this one. Afterwards, they all sit down to a nice family dinner. And yeah, there's a definite Texas Chainsaw vibe in this scene. Hello, I'm Getz, and I'll be your waiter tonight. I hope you enjoy the roasted raccoon. I taxidermied him myself. Then, Getz shares the secret ingredient of this recipe.
C'est bon, hein? C'est quoi exactement?
Ah, c'est cuit dans la graisse de cochon.
They're Muslims, man. Nice work. Didn't they make you take sensitivity training at hospitality college? Well, since you're not gonna eat this raccoon meat, might as well shove it down Grandma's gullet. The airplane is coming in for a landing. Open the hangar door, Grandma. Tom, meanwhile, has decided that this whole Pornhub thing isn't gonna work out after all.
Qu'est-ce qui se passe?
T'avais raison, Farid. C'est des putes.
They're just chilling in the room, waiting for Alex and Yaz to show up, but instead, this cop turns up on their doorstep. Look, I'm sorry I called her a prostitute. It was the pork fat talking. This line of questioning gets real weird real fast.
Me dire que mes sœurs sont des putes, c'est ça?
Non, non.
Elles vous ont fait jouir au moins?
I mean, who knew this guy was the orgasm police? The cop wants the bag of money, but Tom's got other plans. They flee down the stairs and right into a jump scare. Batter up. By God, Triple H just hit Stone Cold with the sledgehammer. Man, my Jim Ross impression sucks. Tom's still alive, but the cop blasts his fingers off. And just like that, there goes all those years of piano lessons. Farid's like, hey man, cut it out, as he stabs the dude with some scissors. They make their escape, but Getz here is in hot pursuit. Farid's trying to get his good driver discount, but this dude has road rage and keeps trying to ride his bumper and pass him on the right. Jesus, did they film this thing in a bounce house? I've seen earthquake footage with less bouncy cam than this sequence. Eventually, Farid takes a wrong turn. Right off a ledge. I don't think the airbags are gonna help with that. Back at the bed and breakfast, we see this isn't the first time these folks have done this. Back at the scene of the accident, Farid and Tom are somehow still alive and able to walk. So they slink off into the darkness of the well. Hey, remember Alex and Yaz? They're still in this movie and they've just arrived at the hotel. These two aren't as easily wowed by Gilberta's feminine charms, so she tells them Tom and Farid stayed at another hotel.
Ouais, ils sont très sympas. Sont partis au gîte un peu plus loin.
Back underground, Farid and Tom find a passageway. And man, when did this turn into the French version of The Descent? Fun fact, I'm totally jaded to horror and gore cinema, but I'm incredibly claustrophobic. So scenes like this terrify me.
J'arrive plus à respirer, j'arrive plus à respirer.
Oh yeah, this is pretty much nightmare fuel for me. I can deal with Nazi cannibals all day, but getting stuck in this dark tunnel? Too much, man. Too much. Are any of you guys claustrophobic and freaked out by scenes like this? Let me know down in the comments section. But just when you think things can't get any worse, they do. Surprise! You're not in this tunnel alone. Man, this really did turn into a French version of The Descent. Tom gets unstuck, but climbs right into another jump scare. He might need a few Advil after that. Dude's got a splitting headache. Then this big dude Hans tries to grab Farid, but he slinks back into the dark. The ladies lead Alex and Yaz back to this abandoned mine.
On est où ici?
Sur le site d'ancienne mine fermée au début du siècle.
No, no, that doesn't seem ominous at all. Farid, meanwhile, is back down in the caverns, but he's clearly not alone. He's getting overrun by this army of chuds. While Alex is off draining the lizard, Yaz takes in the decor. Man, that's some real nice Nazi memorabilia you guys have. Really ties the room together. Alex is busy snooping around and spots Hans. Something's definitely off around here. Back inside, we learn the father is coming, and he's a stickler for good posture.
Qui ça? Le père. Tenez-vous droit, il aime pas quand on est voûté.
Nazi Drayton Sawyer is a good host, though. He welcomes Yaz to his home, and he's gonna read her palm. I've got some bad news. Your lifeline? Not very long. Back outside, Alex has stumbled onto the slaughter room, and they're curing some fresh meat. Too bad it's his pal Tom. Tom's just hanging around, thanks to these gnarly hooks in his feet. Man, he lost fingers and now he has messed up feet. He's never gonna dance again either, apparently. Alex tries to get him off the hooks, but he has to leave him. But hey, look on the bright side. Your cut of that money just got bigger again. Now sure that something's totally wrong about this place, he busts back into the house to grab Yaz and pulls his gun, but surprise, Carl the cop is here and armed too. He stops this revolution by capping Alex in the arm. Don't ruin the meat, man. The arm's the best part. Father here is pretty excited by these new additions, though. He's even got meal prep instructions.
Accroche-les et va les mettre en dégraissage.
He's got other plans for Yaz, even though she's not a pureblood. The family line must go on.
Elle n'est pas pure.
Yeah, see? Getting arrested back at the hospital doesn't look so bad now, does it? Hans is dragging Yaz and Alex off to the pens, but it's the end of the line for Tom. He's off to run cheesy pickup lines on girls in heaven. Farid is still running around underground and finds himself in this meat locker. There's some prime long pig down here, that's for sure. Also, how much do these people eat? Are they doomsday preppers? There's enough people meat down here to last at least a year. Farid's surprisingly calm as he takes this all in, but then he wanders right into another jump scare. Some of this meat is fresher than others. Hans the Butcher thinks the kids have turned on the lights, so he grabs Carl and his gun and sets off to explore. Be very quiet. We're hunting wascoey wabbits. Farid gets the upper hand, but not for long, because Hans gives him a taste of his own medicine. Way to go, Farid. Back in the pens, Alex has gone all Daenerys Targaryen and broken Yaz's chains, but he's still stuck. He does the mature thing and sends her to get help.
Yes, this is in school.
But before she can go, she's got to dig through this pig slop to get out. Delightful. Farid's made it back upstairs now, and he's hiding in this closet. No, wait, that's not a closet, it's a smoker. He's gonna taste amazing after he spends 4 or 5 hours slow roasting in there. Although, no one seasoned him first. Alex and Yaz are still trapped in this cage, surrounded by Nazi cannibals, so this seems like the perfect time to stop and rekindle their romance. No rush, guys. Just take your time. Nazi Drayton Sawyer shows up later, and he's not pleased that Yaz is gone.
Sonya! Bastard! Va me chercher la pince!
I wonder what he's gonna do with those. If you guessed cut his Achilles tendon, then give yourself a screenwriter's credit. Back at the smoker, Farid looks like he might be a little overcooked. He's still alive and looking like the Toxic Avenger, but Hans here finishes him off. Yaz is free now and runs across an oncoming vehicle. And it's so obvious that this is gonna be Getz that I'm not giving out any screenwriter's credits for this one. My dog saw this plot point coming. With Yaz back in the pen, this party can finally get started. Alex has some last words.
Espèce de cendre!
And with that, we say happy trails to Alex. While the fellas are prepping the meat, the ladies are getting Yaz ready for her big date. They figure out she's pregnant, then we jump ahead to find her chained in this room with her new roommate, Eva.
Tu vas dormir dans ma chambre en attendant qu'on t'en prépare une. D'accord?
This chick might be the only normal person here, although normal is pretty subjective in this case. After that, it's time for a day at the Nazi salon. You get not only a haircut, but a lesson on Aryan pride.
Le père dit qu'on appartient à la race parfaite.
Okay, maybe she's not exactly normal. Oh, and those mutants underground? They're her kids.
Non, rien de normal. J'attends mon quatrième, mais bon. Père dit que c'est à cause du sang.
There, you look great. Thanks for coming to Fantastic Sam's. Now that she's all prettied up, it's time for the family dinner. Hope you're hungry, because we're serving Tom tonight. But before we eat, we gotta do this passing of the guard thing. And I'm gonna share some of my crazy eugenics theories with you. Hope you'll humor me.
Il sera le chaînon manquant d'une race pure.
I'll say this, Tom looks pretty tender and delicious.
Vous connaissiez, je crois, non?
One last thing before we can eat. We need to seal this deal with a kiss. Yasmin looks like she's really enjoying it. While everyone's busy toasting, Yaz grabs a knife and makes her move. On today's episode of Jerry Springer, when Nazi Thanksgiving goes wrong. The good news here is that they can live off Hans for at least a decade. Yaz flees to the mine with Getz and Carl in pursuit. Down here, they play a little cat and mouse amongst the corpses. She sees her window of opportunity and hits Triple H with the flying cross body block, but he just shrugs it off, then gives her a little sweet chin music before tossing her around like a rag doll. Then it's time for the table saw. I'm no referee, but I think that counts as a disqualification. While he's busy making sure everything meets OSHA regulations, because safety first and all, she's grabbing the axe. He's screaming about being the leader, and she nails him right in the foot. Guessing those weren't steel-toed boots. Then we come to one of Frontier's most infamous scenes. Yaz isn't done. She nails him again and then slams him onto that table saw. I saw what you did there. She looks like Carrie after being crowned prom queen, but there's still work to be done. Carl sounds the alarm, but Yaz arms herself with a pickaxe and gets back on the elevator. But surprise, here's Carl. He's got her down for the count and is ready to finish her off, but then we're treated to one of the greatest exploding head gags in movie history.
Adieu.
That's right, everyone. Eva is out for revenge. This is probably not what she meant when she said she wanted a bloodbath. She sends Yaz on her way, but there are no keys in the car, so she has to go get them from Alex's corpse. He's salted up nicely. He'll be really tender in a few days. Yaz isn't done, though. She grabs a shotgun and runs into Gilberta and her sister. She's clearly a gamer because she takes cover, then pops out and hits these exploding gas canisters. Did someone order two chicks? Well done. She emerges from the carnage covered in blood to find that Eva is still alive. And somehow, Gilberta is too. Eva tries to get between the two women, but Yaz is gonna end this with her bare hands. This is sort of like a French gender-swapped version of the fight between Riggs and Mr. Joshua at the end of Lethal Weapon, when you think about it. Yaz gets the upper hand, and living with the cannibals all this time has clearly had an impact as she takes a big bite out of Gilberta's throat. Throat meat. Then we get this weird, sort of on-the-nose cleansing rebirth scene. Real subtle, Xavier Gens. Real subtle. Yaz then gets the hell out of there, leaving Eva with her mutant kids and a lot of corpses to clean up. We then cut to Yaz, holding her stomach and driving back to an uncertain future while screaming. But that future has to be better than what she just went through, even in the worst case scenario, right? Except she runs right into a police roadblock. That's a downer, but better than being Nazi cannibal food, I guess. Frontiers is ultimately a bit of a frustrating viewing experience. It's a good 20 minutes longer than it needs to be, the French Texas Chainsaw Massacre motif is not particularly original, and the whole thing somehow feels less than the sum of its parts. It does offer up some pretty good gore, though. How good? Let's go to the gore card and find out. In terms of gross anatomy, our cannibal hosts serve up a nice buffet of gru. We've got a lead pipe beatdown, shot off fingers, meat hooks through the ankles, smoked farid, two clipped Achilles tendons, the table saw massacre, and that fantastic exploding head gag. These new French Extremity films were big on the gore, and Frontiers continues that tradition. Because of that, I'm giving this one 4 barf bags out of 5. Frontiers will definitely make your squeamish friends wince. Want to learn more about New French Extremity? Then check out my review of Inside, one of the crown jewels of this subgenre. You'll find a link to it here on the screen. I'll see you guys over there. Until next time, I'm Mike Bracken, aka The Horror Geek, bringing you all the splatter that matters.